If you want to watch a TV show that's almost perfect in every single way, I highly recommend you watch Avatar: The Last Airbender. On the outside, it looks like it's just a cartoon made for kids, but it's much more than that. The world is vibrant, full of life, the bending system is really well fleshed out, it's dynamic, and it's also used to lean into the themes of the show. The characters feel like real people, and even the most minor characters are never forgettable.
Except the freedom fighters are like that wheelchair kid.
The topics of the show range from literal genocide to dealing with one's past, what forgiveness is, and a whole lot more. For something that aired on Nickelodeon for like an audience of kids, there are some pretty deep and intriguing characters, storylines, and concepts. Now, I would find it hard to believe that if you're actually watching this video, you've never watched Avatar before, but I do want to give a fair warning that this video does spoil the show as I'm talking about the very end of it. So if you've never watched it, please do yourself a favor and watch the whole show before you watch this video. Now, I want you to know what I said about the show. I said it's almost perfect. The show is wonderfully written. I've watched the show 7 times at this point, and the more I watch it, the better it seems to get. But as you can tell by the title of the video, there's a gripe that I have with how the show ends, and it's the neutralization of Fire Lord Ozai and how all that's handled. I think that energy bending has no precedent in the world building, and I think that how Aang discovered energy bending, as well as the very use of it on Ozai, was a complete deus ex machina. Energy bending is a complete contrivance, and I think the show is worse off because of it, and also made for a horrible foundation for the next show.
We're not going to talk about that.
Now, before we get into the details, let's set the stage for anyone that's still watching that hasn't watched the show, or that, you know, might need a reminder. What's the problem, and how does it need to be solved? All right, the problem. Fire Lord Ozai is planning to destroy absolutely everything when Sozin's comet arrives. It amps up the power of firebending to 11. So naturally, Aang, being the Avatar, needs to stop him. The only problem is that Aang believes in the absolute sanctity of life to the point where he will not take Ozai's life to actually stop him. So this issue necessitates that Aang finds a non-violent way to stop Ozai that leaves him alive and in good condition to prevent him from destroying everything. So Aang can't beat him to a pulp and then put him into a coma for eternity, and he definitely can't kill him. So he has to find some way to neutralize him non-violently. So with the stage set, let's discuss what happens, what the writers do, and how the problem is solved, quote unquote. So near the end of the show, Aang still doesn't have a solution for the issue that we just outlined. Because of this, the writers need Aang to either think of a way on his own to non-violently defeat Ozai, or to learn a way to stop Ozai from something or someone. The solution the writers come up with is a massive deus ex machina. Just before what we're about to discuss happens, Aang is arguing with his friends, trying to find a way to stop Ozai without killing him. Eventually, he yells at them, storms off, real angry, and we see him meditating before falling asleep, still unsure of what he's going to do. So while Aang is sleeping, a giant lion turtle shows up in the sea right outside where the gang is staying, which is where the start of my problems are. Now, lion turtles were not talked about much, if at all, in the show, but they were most definitely thought to be a part of the world before. Even though we were just made aware of their existence explicitly here, they were still a part of the show, as there's multiple appearances of them in like decorations and scrolls and all that kind of stuff. Now, the existence of a lion turtle, I am fine with. In a world of giant talking owl librarians, weird face stealers and dragons, I really don't think it's out of the question that there could be some giant primordial lion turtle combination with ancient knowledge or wisdom. I don't hate the idea of Aang speaking to this lion turtle. Aang already has a habit of speaking with super wise people, so why not a lion turtle who was there at basically the beginning of time so that he can help him with his biggest problem yet, right? That's fine. However, the lack of discussion surrounding lion turtles and what their role is in the world, along with the appearance of the only one in existence after it had gone into hiding, makes this appearance jarring and has no real payoff. I honestly think that it could have been a better payoff if the lion turtles were actually more explicitly discussed instead of just mentioned in passing or just shown in decorations. If the lion turtles were more explicitly discussed, it would reward the viewer for paying attention. And when they see this giant lion turtle show up, they can go, "Oh, I remember them talking about this." So, along with the sudden appearance of this lion turtle, Aang stands up and apparently sleepwalking, He jumps over a barrier, down towards the shore, walks into the water, and swims to the lion turtle, later on waking up and finding himself to be riding it. This entire situation is a huge contrivance. This lion turtle, who just so happens to have ancient knowledge Aang just so happens to need, which once again, the existence and discussion with, as I stated earlier, I don't have an issue with. This lion turtle has just randomly appeared in front of Aang out of nowhere. Aang just so happens to sleepwalk onto it. Aang is literally just there to experience the solution. There's no aha moment where Aang, like, I don't know, maybe finds the lion turtle after searching for him or something. Aang is just handed a solution while he's sleeping. So along with all of this, there's no reason to believe this could even happen or any reason to believe it should happen. Given what we know about lion turtles at this point, which by the way is absolutely nothing, it is entirely unbelievable that this giant lion turtle would randomly come out of hiding for Aang to get onto in a drunken stupor and then get help later. When Aang finally actually speaks to the lion turtle, there's no indication that he was even there for Aang. The lion turtle randomly appeared, and Aang just so happened to sleepwalk onto it, just so happened to notice the island he was on was moving, and just so happened to get picked up by the lion turtle to speak to it. Even if this was not a coincidence and this was actually planned by the lion turtle, there is no precedent for me to believe that this lion turtle knew who Aang was, even if he is the Avatar, knew where he was staying, surfaced in the middle of the night, and then knew Aang would sleepwalk onto him, only for him to ask help later. Now, Aang was meditating before all this happened, so I guess we're supposed to chalk it up to some magical, mystical guru stuff where Aang somehow called the lion turtle, but quite frankly, I'm not going to buy that either. During his meditation, there is nothing that shows anything of the sort happens. He meditates a bit, gets tired, goes to sleep, and that's it. No glowing tattoos, no vision, absolutely nothing. I know that the Avatar has some weird spiritual stuff happen around him sometimes, but this is completely out of the blue, even for the Avatar. If they at least showed something, anything happening during Aang's meditation, it might be a little more believable that this lion turtle would surface. Maybe Aang's tattoos start to glow. He's confused about it, ignores it, goes back to sleep, whatever. Maybe Aang has some sort of vision of this turtle, and he doesn't understand it. And he goes to sleep. Anything would be better than nothing. So, when Aang gets up and sleepwalks, maybe show his tattoos slightly glowing. Maybe his eyes are slightly glowing. This shows that it's at least somewhat connected to the spiritual world or him being the Avatar or something like that. But as it is, this giant lion turtle appears from absolutely nowhere. Alright, so, Aang finds himself on a quote-unquote island when he wakes up. He's not sure where he is, he looks around a little bit, and then he finds some sort of weird hexagon thing on the lion turtle. So while he's there, he realizes that he can actually talk with the previous avatars, and he decides to ask him for wisdom so that he can get ideas on how to take down Ozai without killing him. I do like this idea. All the avatars live within Aang.
And I... I'm all the Jedi.
No, not like that. Alright, all the previous avatars live within Aang, and so it makes sense that he'll call on their collective wisdom. But Aang doesn't really like what they have to say. All the previous avatars he speaks with seem to lean towards the idea that Ozai should be killed. Even Avatar Yangshin, an air nomad, tells Aang that for the sake of the world, Ozai needs to die. So after he talks with all the avatars, he gets tired, goes to sleep again, and then wakes up, and he sees mountains in the distance moving closer to him. So he goes up above the forest, above all the trees, and he sees the quote-unquote island he's on is moving. So he jumps into the water and sees a giant paw of the lion turtle, and he starts to swim towards its face. So he swims in front of the lion turtle, really cool scene, his eye opens up, he's all like, oh, what's this, you know, whatever. And the lion turtle stops, picks him up, and Aang asks him for help. He tells him the situation. The lion turtle talks to him something about the true mind weathering lies and illusions and the true heart and all that stuff. And as he talks to him, the lion turtle brings up his other paw and places two of his fingers, or like claws, I don't know, onto Aang's head and chest. So this action presumably taught Aang about energy bending, as when Aang takes away Ozai's bending at the very end, he puts his hands in the same position and there's a flashback of him talking to the lion turtle. And he says,
in the era before the Avatar, we bent not the elements, but the energy within ourselves.
All right, so at this point, energy bending was introduced into the world of Avatar, which completely messes up the entire bending system. To understand this, I want to talk a little bit about the foundation of bending itself and a couple of what I'm calling energy bending adjacents. One of these adjacents is a bending subset, and the other is not even a bending thing at all. It doesn't even require bending. So taking a look at the foundations of bending and the subsets, it'll show how chi energy is supposed to be used and how the energy bending is a complete departure from the otherwise well-balanced and sensible system. So I'm about to do what every shonen anime does.
Avatar is not an anime.
And explain the magic system directly. So bear with me for a little bit. So at the very foundation of bending is the idea of energy, or what Avatar calls chi. Every bender, be they water, earth, fire, or air, all use their chi to bend the elements. So essentially, they can control the flow of their chi through their natural pathways, and then usually direct it outside of their body so that they can interact with the element that they are most in tune with. So this chi, or more specifically the chi pathways, are also the basis of two other abilities, which, as I stated earlier, I'm calling energy bending adjacents for reasons you'll see later, which are one, healing, which is a water bending sub-ability, and chi blocking, which doesn't require bending at all. So the first ability I want to talk about is water bending and healing. We're first shown the art of healing when Katara, Sokka, and Aang visit the Northern Water Tribe. A waterbender named Yagoda is seen using a dummy to teach beginners about the healing ability. So, healing, like regular bending, is somewhat related to chi, except healing actually involves using the chi of the one who is being healed to accelerate the healing process of an external wound. Ah, well, that's already a sort of energy bending, you might be saying. The healers are manipulating the chi of the one needing healed, so in advanced form, like the lion turtle taught Aang, it makes complete sense. And on the surface, sure, it looks like that, but there are some issues. First, healing requires water as a catalyst. A large part of the healing effect is dependent entirely on the quality of the water. The chi of the one being healed is not directly interacted with, like the energy bending. Second, and the most important part, healing does not directly manipulate the chi itself. You can see this when Yagoda is demonstrating on the dummy. You can see the chi pathways on the dummy. The user is not directly bending chi to heal that person. They are using the water as a catalyst for the chi to flow through, which then redirects the chi to a specific place to accelerate healing. Now, I'm calling this an energy bending adjacent, because on the outside, it does look like the bender is somehow manipulating the chi of another person directly. But when you dig deeper, they're simply exploiting the natural flow of the chi with water as a natural catalyst. All right, so with that first energy bending adjacent, let's look at one more. This one is the one that's most similar in appearance to the energy bending Aang uses on Ozai, because this one involves taking away bending. I'm of course talking about chi blocking. This one is most famously used by Ty Lee. Now, the effects of chi blocking can be twofold. Chi blocking can be used to just render a person's muscles completely useless, or it can be used to temporarily disable bending. Aha, my straw man says, Aang completely takes away Ozai's bending. Ty Lee shows that taking away bending is possible. It only makes sense that even a stronger version could exist and take it away forever. Oh, my sweet little straw man. As with healing, there's still issues. Just like with healing, chi blocking exploits the chi pathways within the body, not a direct manipulation of the chi itself. When you see Ty Lee using this ability, you see her using quick jabs at a specific point of the body. These are carefully chosen pressure points that she jabs at to stop a chi flow. It's like creating a dam in a river that completely stops the chi flow on the other side. Now, the reason that I imagine it's temporary is because of how it works. It's like a dam. If you flood a dam with a massive inflow of water, it could break, or the water could end up flowing over it, regaining a flow entirely. As with healing, the chi blocking does not manipulate the chi directly. It's always focused on the chi flow. The effects of chi blocking also help to further strengthen my argument for healing. When Ty Lee attacks the airbenders in Ba Sing Se, Katara tries to heal an earthbender, but she's not able to. The reason is because, once again, healing uses the natural flow of chi in the body. Because there's an issue with the flow of chi after chi blocking is used, there's nothing a healer could do. It's like trying to use the body's immune system to heal the disease, but the immune system has already failed. You can't use that which is already failing to heal the actual thing that needs fixed. So, our quick look into the role of chi in the foundation of bending, and the two abilities of healing and chi blocking, show the delicate balance of chi in the bending system that already exists. It shows that only the bender himself can actually manipulate his chi directly, although even then, I'd argue that it's more likely the bender is manipulating the actual paths within himself, just like the other abilities, and that abilities that appear to manipulate others' chi is just using the natural flow of it. To introduce the ability to manipulate energy at all, let alone someone else's energy, disrupt the entire bending system that's already in place. It completely breaks everything and opens the door to more questions and overpowered abilities. I think the writers realized this, and so they tried to do damage control. They ended up saying things to try to limit the use of such an ability, such as, very few avatars had the ability to use it, and even fewer actually went through with it. And then they added the idea of a good and bad energy, and an energy needing to be super pure to actually use energy bending, so that using energy bending is risky and costly, thereby reducing the use of it even more. The only issue with this is that reducing the usage of a world-breaking ability does not solve the issue. It simply gives you less of the world-breaking issue. Now, I want to give the writers the benefit of the doubt here. I'm not going to pretend that I know what was going on in the writing room, but what I think happened was that Nickelodeon didn't want Ozai to get killed because it's too graphic and violent, even though they dealt with literal genocide in the third episode, and so the writers had to find a way to subdue him. I don't know if the writers were still writing as the show was airing or not, but it seems to me that what they did was write themselves into a corner. Maybe this was due to Nickelodeon's restrictions. Once again, I don't know, this is all conjecture, but they probably wrote themselves into a corner and needed a way out. So they thought, what if we just took away Ozai's bending? He's completely powerless without his bending. Now, especially if they were writing the end of the show just as the rest of it was airing, I can completely understand the scramble to find a quick and easy way to take away Ozai's bending. The one thing I will say about the final scene where Aang takes away Ozai's bending is that it looked cool as heck. The visuals in that scene are awesome, and even if it is a bit on the nose, I do kind of like the visual representation of the struggle between good and evil as we see Aang and Ozai's colors, you know, red and blue, struggling back and forth. As this video has shown, though, I am not a fan of the deus ex machina lion turtle showing up and teaching Aang energy bending, a world-breaking ability, and I'm not a fan of the implications energy bending has on the rest of the world. Now, I think it's unfair to critique a story or an ability without coming up with an alternative. A part of constructive criticism isn't just pointing out what's wrong with something, but also pitching a different, possibly better idea. So in this video, I'm going to pitch another possible ending. My ending is probably not going to be seen as a solution by a whole lot, but this is personally how I wouldn't have minded seeing the show end. So I haven't gone into a whole lot of detail with this ending, and it could obviously be expanded upon, fleshed out, improved upon more, written better, whatever, but I think this could be a pretty interesting conclusion to the show. Now, I want to start back before the lion turtle surfaces while Aang is sleeping. Aang is arguing with his friends, and he's getting angry that he's not found a way to non-violently subdue Ozai. He storms off and begins to pace around. He talks to Momo for a second, saying that he just wishes he could speak to the other avatars and get some wisdom from them. And then he realizes he can. He calms himself down, lights some candles, sits down to meditate, and begins to speak to the avatars. They all give their responses to Aang. They're clearly leaning towards Ozai's life to save everyone. Aang is clearly distressed. He calls on another avatar. The rest of the avatars are telling me I need to kill Ozai, even Avatar Yangshin. How could an air nomad just throw away a life like that? He tells this unnamed avatar. I understand the problem you have and that you seek wisdom from us. However, I know I too will give you an unsatisfactory answer to your problem. So I want to give you an opportunity to gain wisdom from someone else, someone who has even more knowledge and wisdom than all the avatars combined. After this talk with that unnamed avatar, we see Aang take off, ready to find this wise person, whoever it is. We cut to Aang sitting on a cliff over the sea. He's meditating again. His tattoos start to glow, and a rumbling comes from the water as a giant island comes out of it. Slowly, the face of the lion turtle starts to move up over the cliff, and eventually Aang comes face to face with it. He bows, tells the lion turtle his dilemma, and asks for help. The lion turtle responds, Aang, you were taught well by the air nomads that all life is sacred. However, one thing you must also remember is that tandem with life is death. Everything and everyone must die eventually, even if it must regrettably be brought to an end by someone else. My brothers were hunted until I became the last of my kind. However, even in their death, I am connected to my brothers and all those that have died before me. An attempt should be made to preserve life as much as possible. But if one must die to save many, then so it should be, especially to protect the ones you love dearly. The lion turtle raises his paw, puts two of his claws on Aang's forehead and chest, and he remembers what Avatar Kyoshi said. He remembers what Avatar Yangchen says. Then he remembers the moment he found Monk Gyatso at the air temple. We see his body surrounded by dead firebenders. At that point, Aang realizes that even Monk Gyatso was willing to take life if necessary to try and protect those he loves. So the lion turtle sinks back down, and inside Aang we see a sadness, but a resolve in his eyes. He understands the sanctity of life and how that means that sometimes one life must be taken to save millions of others. When Ozai and Aang actually battle, Aang restrains him with his avatar state. But before he kills Ozai, he comes out of it. He looks at Ozai with sadness, but knows what he has to do. He looks at Ozai and he says, "I'm sorry, I have to save the ones I love," and quickly and painlessly kills Ozai. Now, as I mentioned earlier, it's quite possible that Nickelodeon refused to let Ozai get killed because Avatar is a kid's show. But in an ideal world, I would want to see something like this happen. Not only did Ozai have to die, but it shows that Aang had to make a sacrifice by killing someone so that he could save the world and his loved ones. This action would have been perfect grounds to explore more in the next Avatar show. It's what we could have got instead of what we did get. It could have followed Aang in the aftermath of this action, wondering if what he did was right, showing him dealing with guilt or trauma from it. It would have been a great catalyst for an exploration of even more themes and different characters. Now, despite all the criticisms I've given to the show in the video, I do want to make it clear that I still love Avatar: The Last Airbender, and it's probably my favorite show of all time. I just think that the ending and the inclusion of energy bending robbed the show of making it essentially perfect. Now, despite that, please go watch the show if you haven't before, or if you have, rewatch it. Honestly, this show deserves a lot of praise and deserves to be watched at least 100 times by every human being before they die.